Good afternoon, and depending on where you are, good evening or good morning. It's always a pleasure to be together and learn together. This class is part of Drisha's Spring Zman. Today, discussions on the parasha is with Dr. Hanan Gafni, and it's on Parashat Ki Tisa. Just a reminder on how we run the classes. I'm letting a few people in right now. If you're receiving an invitation to become a panelist, it would just allow you to participate verbally in class if you wish. As a panelist, you can choose to keep your video on or off. By the way, Dr. Gafni, it looks like you're frozen again. You might want to restart again if you can hear me. We're having a little bit of a technical difficulty here that we might need to sort out after I do the introduction. And just a few words about Dr. Hanan Gafni, who studied at Mir Yeshiva in Jerusalem while earning his academic degrees from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem and Harvard University. He currently teaches at Hebrew University and Ben Gurion University. His publications include the Mishnah's Plain Sense, 2011, and most recently, Conceptions of the Oral Law in Modern Jewish Scholarship, 2019. And let me see if, okay, perfect. Dr. Gafni, I'll turn this to you now, okay?
Okay, thank you so much. Just one correction, I don't teach at Ben-Gurion University. Okay, so I'm going to start by sharing my screen. Okay, so the theme of today's lecture will be, I'll read it first in Hebrew, then in English. I call the lecture Re'iyat Pnei Hashem Baregalim, or I would translate this literally, viewing the face of God on holidays. So we're going to try to discuss a theme that comes up again and again in the parshiyot that we're surrounded by, meaning it starts already with Parshat Mishpatim, and it also involves Parashat Terumah and Tetzaveh and Parashat Ki Tisa. All this collection of parshiyot, we'll start with Parshat Ki Tisa, but it really is a theme that involves all of the parshiyot we're dealing with now. And I want to start by reciting a few verses in the Torah, mainly I would say in Sefer Shmot and in Sefer Dvarim, Exodus and Deuteronomy, where we have three elements that appear in all those verses. The elements are, it involves the verb seeing, that's one element. It also connects the act of the seeing to Pnei Hashem or Pnei Ha'adon Hashem, the face of God. And also another element, it also always takes place during the holidays. Shalosh pe'amim bashana. So let's read a bunch of these verses. I'm starting with the verse on source number one. Do you see the screen? Okay, so the first source is from our parasha. It says, Shalosh pe'amim bashana, yera'e kol zchucha et pnei ha'adon Hashem Elohei Yisrael. So you see, I put in bold letters the main two elements. We have the viewing, the seeing part, the root ra'ah, and we also have something about the face of God, the face of the Lord God. So that's another element in the story, and it's referring to the three holidays. The same also appears in Shmot Perek Kaf Gimel Pasuk Yud Zayin. That's in Parashat Mishpatim. Shalosh pe'amim bashana yira'e kol zruchav el pnei ha'adon Hashem. And I'll read one more source for now. In Sefer Dvarim, in Parashat Re'eh, Shalosh pe'amim bashana yira'e kol zruchav el pnei Hashem Elohecha b'makom asher yivchar, b'chag ha'matzot, b'chag ha'shavuot, u'b'chag ha'sukkot, v'lo yira'e pnei Hashem reikam. I'm sure you're familiar with this, because it comes up again and again and again. Seeing the face of God during the holidays. Here on the next screen, I gave you another two instances. Source number four is again from the current parasha, Parashat Ki Tisa. Again, Ve'lo yachmod ish et arzecha, ba'alotcha leiraot et pnei Hashem Elohecha shalosh pa'amim bashana. I'm not reading the translation now because we will need to address that in a second. But here too, you see seeing the face of God three times a year. And finally, I brought one more source. This is from Sefer Dvarim in the context of Mitzvat Hakel, that all of the people of Am Yisrael come. And again, we see the verb seeing the face of God in this event. So these are the, this is the basic structure that appears again and again and again. And I want to start with a grammatical problem that emerges when you read pretty much all those verses, all those cases that we just read before. So the word, usually what we have two types of verbs. We can have verbs that appear in the active form, and we have verbs that appear in a passive form. When you have a verb that comes in an active form, form with a subject, so then you can have an object, a direct object that follows it. For example, I'm sitting here in Yerushalayim, I see you, so I'm this subject, and actively I see you. You are the direct object. So that's one option that in Hebrew. However, if the verb appears in a passive verb form, meaning to be seen, so then it cannot be followed by a direct object, meaning I can't say a sentence such as I seen you, meaning I'm seeing you, because you is the direct object, and it can only follow in an active verb, but not when I'm saying something in passive. Why am I saying this? Because here we have a similar problem in Hebrew. The root, the verb, re'ya, seeing, appears in all these verses in a passive form. Shalosh pamim bashana yeira'eh. Yeira'eh literally translates, will be seen. Right? Shalosh pamim bashana yeira'eh kol zchucha. Three times a year, all of the males shall be seen. However, it follows by a direct object, et pnei ha'adon Hashem. But we can't be seen somebody else. We can be seen by somebody else, but we can't be seen somebody else. This is just not a pattern from a grammatical perspective that works out. Just like I can't say I seen you. It doesn't work. So how can the Torah use the same pattern over and over again? Shalosh pamim bashana yeira'e, will be seen, et pnei Adon Hashem. How can we be seen somebody else? It just doesn't work. And the same problems emerges over and over again. Shalosh pamim bashana yeira'e kol zchucha et pnei Adon Hashem. Shalosh pamim bashana, in the second source, yeira'e kol zchucha et pnei Adon Hashem. Again, usually with the word et, you can't be seen somebody else. So how do we deal with this? If you see the English translations, they're trying to smoothen this problem to get around that issue, but it's not really a literal translation. You see that in the English translation, they translate three times a year, shall all thy males appear before the Lord God. So it's not really seeing. You're supposed to appear, and it doesn't say you will appear the Lord God. You will appear before the Lord God. So then you're actually being treated in a passive form, but you can't be using a passive form and then follow a direct object. All those English translations are going around that problem. They're not really capturing the original Hebrew. And this is true with all those translation. I chose the JPS English translation, but also in other translations, it doesn't really work. You see, usually it's being translated to appear before the Lord, but that's not what the text is saying. It says, Leira'ot et bnei Hashem. So I want to add one more thing. There are numerous other verses in the Tanakh where we do find the correct form, meaning sometimes a person is able to see somebody else, and then it doesn't use the passive verb, it uses the active form. See, for instance, in source number one here, where we have it's a pasuk from Sefer Shmuel, Ach davar echad ani shoel meitcha lemor, lo tir'e et panai. So here, makes sense. You cannot see my face. So the verb appears in an active form, and then it could follow a direct object. You cannot see my face, but you can't be seen my face. That doesn't work. Also in the end of that verse, bevo'acha lir'ot et panai. Lir'ot et ha'panim shel mishu acher, to see somebody else's face makes sense, but you can't be le'ra'ot. You can't be seen somebody else. In Daniel, lama yir'eh et pnechem zo'afim. Makes sense. Why shall he see your face? Active verb, then follows by a direct object, but not in the passive form. Alternatively, when the Tanakh, when the Mikra wants to talk about it in a passive form, it will usually use a different pattern, and the whole structure of the sentence will be different. See, for example, number four. Vayelech Eliyahu leheiraot el Achav. That can work. You can be seen by somebody else. That works. But you can't see somebody else. You can't leiraot somebody else. So the verb really does not make much sense in its current grammatical form. Is the problem clear? I hope I made myself clear. So I want to come up, not come up, I want to quote a radical suggestion that was offered by very important scholars in the 19th century, two important scholars. It's a radical idea. It's a textual emendation of the text. And this is going to be the starting point for our class. So you just have to accept what I'm saying now, and then we can go on. Numerous scholars, and again, I'm starting by quoting these two famous scholars. One of them was Shadal, Shmuel David Luzzatto, Samuel David Luzzatto from Italy. And another guy who follows the same approach was Abraham Geiger from Germany. Both of them suggest that the text here was really formulated differently originally, and it was only changed or revised due to some theological problem. What do scholars suggest, starting from Shmuel David Luzzatto and many, many others? So they're suggesting, the suggestion is that initially, all those verses that I quote before, I'm going back on the screens before, all those verses that we mentioned didn't actually have the verb written in a passive form. It really appeared in an active form. The original pronunciation of the text was Shalosh Pe'amim Bashana, not Yeira'e in the passive form, but rather Shalosh Pe'amim Bashana, Yir'e Kol Zvucha Etnei Adon Hashem. The original reading, the original pronunciation of all those verses were actually, indeed, in active form. Three times a year, you shall see the face of God. You shall view the face of God. In all those verses, the original pronunciation was actually in the active form. Shalosh pa'amim bashana yir'e kol zchucha et pnei Adon Hashem. Or in, let's say, in Deuteronomy, the third source. Shalosh pa'amim bashana yir'e kol zchucha et pnei Hashem Elohecha b'makom asher yibchar. All those verses, in according to the original pronunciation, were actually in the active form. Or moving to the source 4 and 5. Lo yachmod ish et arzecha, nobody should desire or want your land. Ba'alotcha lir'ot et pnei Hashem. The original reading was seeing or coming in an active way to see the face of God. And finally, in source number 5, Bevokol Israel lir'ot et pnei Hashem Elohech. This is the suggestion or the textual emendation that Shmuel David Luzzatto, Samuel David Luzzatto suggests. And his theory was that the text was revised at some point in history due to the theological problem, to a very big theological problem. Samuel David Luzzatto argues that originally, if the text actually said that one is supposed to come three times a year to see the face of God, that obviously raises a problem. How can one see the face of God, right? God doesn't have an image. So Luzzatto argues that in order to avoid or to prevent this type of impression that the one is able to see the face of God, that God has a physical image, the Ba'alei HaNikud, the people who put in the vowels, changed the way that the word was pronounced. And rather than presenting it as coming to see God, it was presented as if you are coming to be seen by God, or you're coming to, it appears in a passive form. And by doing that, you really avoid leaving the impression that one is capable of viewing or glancing at the face of God. But originally, the original formulation was that a person is supposed to come and see God three times a year.
Dr. Gaffney, yes. Is that the name of a town, or is he related to Moshe Chaim Luzzatto?
He is part of that same family, but he's a little bit later. Ramchal appeared more than 100 years before him. Luzzatto lived between 1800 and 1865. Yeah, those are his years. He was a very important teacher in the rabbinical seminary in Italy, in the city of Padua. That's where he was the teaching. Let's read it in his words. He says, I'm reading it first in Hebrew and then we'll read it in English. Kavanat ha-mikra lomav, meaning the Torah really meant to say, lir'ot panai, to see my face. And the Torah originally meant to say that, v'hi melitza derech mashal, it was formulated in a poetic form. However, ba'alei ha-nikud, efes, ba'alei ha-nikud, tiknu ha-lashon derech kavod. The people who put the punctuations corrected the text out of respect to avoid the conception of that God has an actual body or physical appearance, so that it will not appear as if man sees the face of God. This is Luzzatto's idea, and the same is also repeated by Abraham Geiger following Luzzatto. He quotes Luzzatto and accepts his idea that this is really a new formulation of the same text. From their perspective, the vowels were able to, those people, the Masoretic sages, were able to change the pronunciation, but they didn't want to change the words themselves. So the word et in an active form still remains, but the nature, but the sense of the verse was changed into something being said in the passive. Is this clear so far? This is the difficult part of today's class. From now on, everything easy. But this is a really very crucial starting point for our entire discussion. So we concluded so far, summarizing, although the text is pronounced in the passive form, the original formulation was probably in an active form. One was commanded to see the face of God three times a year. That would work from a grammatical perspective. It was only due to some theological concerns, argue many scholars, that the pronunciation was moderated or revised, turning the active verb of seeing into something in a passive form, to be seen. If you accept this, if you're still with me, so now we're going to start our class. And the class will start by asking a very simple question. If indeed, the Torah was suggesting, was commanding, that one is supposed, as I said here before, that one is supposed to see the face of God three times a year, well, that would be a very poor choice of words. And I think it's a poor decision to use this formulation for two reasons. Why? So the first thing, obviously, is a theological problem. How can the Torah command a person to see the face of God if God doesn't have a face, right? In numerous places, the Torah itself says that en lo guf, en lo dmut haguf, God does not have any form, any physical form. So how can the Torah? Yes.
But in chapter 33, verse 11, it sounds like the Lord would speak to Moshe face to face.
Okay, excellent. We're getting there. Excellent. But I want to start before you say that. Very good point. That's where we're going. Okay,
great.
So what my question is, if indeed the original formulation was that God wants people to see his face three times a year, well, that brings up a big problem. A, because God is not supposed to have a face. But furthermore, within the context of the same commandment in Parashat Ki Tisa, we actually hear something which is, you know, exactly the opposite. I'm reminding you, and here I'm moving back and forth in the presentation. A few verses before, right before God commands us to see his face three times a year, we read about Moshe. Moshe has a very special request. He says, Akadosh Baruch Hu asks God, Hareini nait kevodecha, let me see your glory. And what does God tell him? Vayomer. God answers, Lo tuchal lirot et panai, ki lo irani adam v'chai. He says, thou can't see my face, for man shall not see me and live. A person cannot observe, cannot view the face of God. Rather, what God suggests, Vayomer Hashem, hinei makom iti benitzavta al atzur, rather, you should stay somewhere on the rock, And vaya ba'avor kvudi v'samticha benikrat atzur v'sakoti kapi alecha ad ovri v'asiroti et kapi v'ra'ita et achorai u'fanai lo ira'u. I'm reading it in English. And it shall come to pass while my glory passes by that I will put thee in a cleft of the rock and will cover thy with my hand until I have passed by. I will take my hand, I'll take away my hand and thou shalt see my back, but my face shall not be seen. Ufanai lo yira'u. Well, if God is making it so clear to Moshe that one cannot see his face, perhaps only his back, but not his front, how can the Torah command Shalosh pe'amim b'shana yir'e kol zruchah et pnei Hashem? So how can the Torah ask us, command us to see God's face three times a year? If five verses before, when Moshe was asking to see the face of God, he was clearly instructed this is not something possible. If you recall, with Moshe, it has a long history. When Moshe sees the burning bush, he also wants to see what's going on. And God tells him, again, you're not, and Moshe has to cover his face because Moshe again and again learns that one cannot see the face of God. God, one cannot observe God. So how can the Torah tell us three times a year one is supposed to go and see et pnei Adon Hashem, see the face of God? Furthermore, at the end of the parasha, it seems like an independent story, but I think that it's a continuation of the same theme. At the very end of the parasha, we hear that Moshe goes down from Mount Sinai, and he's not fully aware of the fact that his face is shining, is glowing. And the text says as follows. I'm reading in Hebrew first and then in English. Vayar Aharon, v'chol b'nei Yisrael et Moshe, v'hine karan or panav, v'yir'u migeshet elav. So Aharon and all the people of Israel see Moshe, and his face is glowing, and they're scared to approach him. What happens then? Moshe understands that if he wants to communicate with the people, with the rest of the Am Yisrael, so he has to cover his face. Vayechal Moshe midaber itam, vayiten al panav masve. So Moses understands that if he wants to speak to them, he has to cover his face. He has to put a veil over his face. A side point. In modern Hebrew, for how do we call a mask? How do you say mask in modern Hebrew?
Masecha.
But that's a little bit funny because the word masecha, which also appears in our parasha, has a whole different meaning. The word masecha in the parasha, in our parasha, appears by the egel. And it says, Shem asu egel masecha. Masecha in biblical Hebrew does not mean a mask. It just means something that you, some metal that you turn into some shape. It's called masecha. Linsoach is to shape something with metal, right? So it's a whole different word. The word for mask in our parasha is actually masve. In modern Hebrew, people use the word masecha to talk when they talk about a mask. I think for two reasons: A, because it resembled the word masach, something that covers, or because of the word mask in English. Masecha and mask sound the same, so people changed the meaning of the word masecha and gave it a new interpretation or a new meaning, but the original word in the Torah is actually masveh. Masveh is really a mask in biblical Hebrew. Back to our topic. So Moshe covers his face with a veil, right? And the text says, and uvevo Moshe lifnei Hashem nedaber ito yasir et ha-masveh ad seto, v'yatza v'diber el bnei Yisrael et asher yitzuveh. So whenever Moshe approaches God, so he takes off the veil until he came out. And then when he came out and spoke to the people of Israel, so then he covers the face again. Why is the Torah telling all of this here? I think it's a continuation of the same theme that came up before. Moshe wants to see the face of God, and God tells him, you cannot see my face, right? Now the Torah goes and says even one step further. It's not just that one can't see the face of God. You can't even see the face of somebody who had any sort of communication with God. As soon as Moshe comes down from Har Sinai, people can't even see his face, not to mention God's face himself. So this is a very long or big theme in the entire parasha. seeing the face of God or even somebody who had some contact with God is something that is impossible. So if that is the case, it appears like a very poor choice to formulate a mitzvah, a commandment, 3 times a year. One is supposed to see the face of God. Didn't we just say that this is something impossible? Right? Lo tochal lirot et panai. We can't see the face of God. We can't see even people who communicated with God, but not to mention God himself. So why does the Torah use this pattern? Well, we can start finding cases, rare cases, where the Torah does use this formulation in some form of melitza, or I'd say in a poetic manner, and it does. And we might argue that this is not something that needs to be taken so literally. You mentioned before, who was mentioning the panim et panim before? Somebody was just asking about the panim et panim. Right. So we Sorry. Do have that. Who is the first person who speaks to God panim et panim before Moshe? So I'll give you the next slide. So you see, he's not the only one. We have Yaakov names the place called Pniel after he battles with the angel. Vayikra Yaakov shem ha-makom Pniel, Pniel, the face of God. Ki ra'iti Elohim panim el panim. So here Moshe, Yaakov says, he calls the name of the place Pniel, for I have seen God face to face. So we do have that in rare occasions. Also later on when Yaakov speaks to his brother and he begs him to take his present, his mincha, his offering, he says, "V'lakachta minchati miyadi, ki al ken ra'iti panecha kirot pnei Elohim." For as much as I have seen thy face, as one sees the face of God. So we do have this expression. It does appear in other cases. It even appears in our parasha once. It says by Moshe, "V'diber Hashem el Moshe panim el panim, kasher yedaber ish el re'ehu." The Lord spoke to Moses face to face, like two people speak to each other, like a person speaks to his friend. So the expression does appear elsewhere. But I think we're still a little bit confused. I still find this to be a very poor choice of words, right? If the Torah wants to say, come visit Yerushalayim 3 times a year, it's much, you can formulate that in so much easier ways. Just say, Shalosh pamim bashana, ya'ale kol zruha liYerushalayim. I recommend doing that. 3 times a year, come to Yerushalayim. Why use the words lirot yireh pnei Hashem or shalosh pnei shana yireh kol zrucha et pnei Adon Hashem Elohi Yisrael? It's just a poor choice of words. What does the Torah mean by saying that? How can the Torah not be aware of this formulation that is so puzzling within the context of our parasha, parashat Ki Tisa, and of the parashiot that's surrounded? What I want to suggest is that the Torah itself offers some clue what it means when it says that when you come 3 times a year, you're actually able to see the face of God. This is actually something that the Torah is aware of. This problem is not something that I'm coming up with. This difficulty, this challenge is actually noticed by the Torah itself, and I think the Torah is giving us a clue what it means. And what I want to suggest here is something that I feel is rooted in the verses themselves. It's not going to solve all of our problems, but I think it's an interesting start for how to tackle this problem. So we focused so far on Parashat Mishpatim a little bit, and mainly on Parashat Ki Tisa. But Parashat Ki Tisa is surrounded by 4 other parashot that talk about the Mishkan. Parashat Truma and Tetzaveh speak about or present the commandments that one is supposed to build the Mishkan, what will later on become the temple. And in Parashat Vayakel and Pekudei, we see how these commandments were actually have been carried out. If I wanted to give you an interesting quiz, and I'm not going to do that, so I would ask you, how many physical organs appear in the parshiot, or human organs appear in the parshiot of the Mishkan? If you will see, if you will go through these parshiyot, you will see that many parts of the human body appear in the context of the parshiyot of the Mishkan, when the Torah is trying to tell us how to actually build all those vessels or the structure itself. I'll give you some examples. The Torah speaks about legs, raglaim. Which vessel has raglaim? The menorah has raglaim. The menorah has also yerechaim. We have rosh hakrashim, the wood pieces that form the structure itself. They have rashim. We have zeret. We have etzba. We have ama. All those are physical organs, human organs that appear in the course of the description. And usually it's meant to give us a sense of measurements or to talk about something on top or on the bottom, in the front or in the back. And by doing that, you employ or you borrow those terms that are human, terms that belong to the human body or human organs when you describe the Mishkan. But there's one term that keeps repeating itself in a rather surprising way. And I think that it doesn't just appear to convey something technical about front and back, or tall and high, or bottom and top, or a measurement. And what am I referring to? I know you already guessed by now. Which word, which body, which part of the body keeps repeating itself in somewhat unexpected manners or unexpected way? You should guess by now, even if you didn't hear this talk before. Which part of the body will keep on repeating itself?
It's not Yadayim, Panim?
Panim. Yadayim also appear. La Krashim Yesh Yadot. Each one of the Krashim has two Yadayim, those two parts on the bottom. But I'm referring to the root Panim. The word Panim repeats in the parasha in very unexpected ways, and not just to talk about front and back. It's something beyond that. It's giving us the feeling that some of the vessels, some of the kelim of the Mishkan, actually have something that is associated with the face. So which vessels, which kelim in the Mishkan include something that involves a face?
Well, there's the kruvim.
Excellent. So let's start with the first one. I know you didn't see the presentation before, so it's a good guess. In the Kruvim, it says as follows: Vasu Aron and Sei Shitim. So you shall make the Aron. Aser Kruv Echad Mikatzam Izeh, Vekruv Echad Mikatzam Izeh, Mina Kaporet Asu Et Kruvim Al Shnei Ketzotav. So you're supposed to create the Kruvim. Vehayu Kruvim Porsech Nafayim Lemala, Sochachim Bechanfehem Al Kaporet, Ufneihem Ish El Achim, El Kaporet Yu Pnei Kruvim. And the Kruvim shall spread out their wings on high, screening the ark cover with their wings, with their faces one to another. Towards the ark cover shall the faces of the Kruvim be. Now, the faces of the Kruvim is not just the front of the Kruvim. The Kruvim actually have a face shape. The word Kruvim itself, some scholars argue, if starting from the Gemara, is a baby figure, but it talks about their faces. So those Kruvim actually had faces. So we started with the faces of the Kruvim on top of the Aron, on top of the Ark. Which other Panim do we find in the course of the Melechet HaMishkan?
It doesn't have a face, but there's called Lechem HaPanim. So
excellent. So we have Lechem HaPanim. Excellent. Look, it says once, Vasita Shulchan Atzei Shitim, Venatata La Shulchan, so you're supposed to create this table, and Venatata La Shulchan Lechem Panim Lefanai Tamid. So we have here Lechem that is called Lechem Panim. I don't know if this is the way it's translated often in English. I don't know if there are other translations here. I saw it's translated, you should set upon the table showbread. Do people say that? That's how we call lechem hapanim, lechem panim.
Yes.
So this is the common translation. I didn't even know if it's unique to this English translation or if that's the standard way people translate this word.
Yes, and but sometimes it's spelled like shoe bread, S-H-E-W. I've seen it.
Which means what? The same?
I don't know what show bread is, so I don't know if it's the same.
I guess it's something that is supposed to be exhibited, or we'll talk about it in a second. But the choice, again, of referring to lechem panim is rather surprising.
Zella, excuse me, Zella, the S-H-E-W spelling is antiquated English. So it's possible, you know how Bibles, when they were translated, were written in a stilted, kind of stilted way. Perhaps even, you know.
I still see it.
So S-H-E-W is also show. But in any case, so I think the shoe bread is pronounced show bread. And I think it's just an antiquated version.
Okay, good. Also in Sefer Bamidbar, it's not even called Lechem HaPanim. The table itself is called Shulchan HaPanim. Right? We don't even refer to the word panim only with regards to the bread, but also the table itself is called Shulchan HaPanim. So we already saw Aaron has something that involves panim. HaShulchan also has an element of panim. So what are we going to look for now? You already know what I'm going to look for. Which other vessel must have panim?
Menorah should have one.
So let's see if the menorah has a panim.
And the ketoret, the curtain. And look,
so it says here, Vasita menorat zahav taor, vasita et neroteha shiva, ve'ela et neroteha, ve'ir al ever paneha. Ve'alotcha et hanerot el mul peneya menorah. So again, you can talk about the front, but it's an awkward choice. Le'ir al ever paneha, very, very awkward grammatical way of presenting. If you just want to say, it's supposed to heat light over against it, as they translate this in English. It's using the word panim in all those cases in a very, in almost obsessive manner. So what do I want to suggest? And then I will try to prove it. Perhaps when the Torah is trying to talk about the panim that are visible, both with regards to the kuvim and with regards to the shulchan and with regards to the menorah, maybe when the Torah was talking about la'alot, lir'ot et pnei Hashem, it's a way of saying, come and viewing those vessels, those kelim, that have some form that represent in one way or another the face of God. So it's not really just an abstract way of saying, come and visit God, come and see God. Maybe the Torah was thinking on some level that when people came, when the Olim LaRegel came to Yerushalayim, they actually did see something in the very physical manner, not an abstract formulation, but something more physical. When you came to the Mishkan or to Beit HaMikdash, and you saw the Aron, and you saw the Shulchan, and you saw the Menorah, in some awkward way, you were seeing the face of God. Now, I know it might sound a little bit weird to you, and what I want to now is to show you that this is indeed the way that I think at least some rabbis understood this expression. So how can we see this? So far we just had throughout the presentations, psukim, verses. What I want to do now is read a bunch of texts from Chazal. And through those texts, I will try to demonstrate that this understanding existed in the writings of Chazal. So which text is going to be the most fitting place to start looking for? So there's a tractate in the Mishnah that talks about the mitzvah of Aliyah LaRegel. Which tractate in the Mishnah in Seder Moed talks about Aliyah LaRegel? We're talking about Masechet Chagiga. Masechet Chagiga, one of the last Masechtot in Tractate Moed, is devoted mainly to the mitzvah of Aliyah LaRegel. It's weird that the Masechet is called Masechet Chagiga, that it's named Masechet Chagiga, because it should have actually been called not Chagiga, but rather, if the key word in Aliyah LaRegel is what? viewing the face of God, how would you expect the Mishnah to be called? And how would we expect this Masechet to be named? Masechet?
Oh, Sandra, just make sure to unmute. I think Sandra is trying to talk, but she just...
Yeah, I can't hear. Okay, so I will give you an... We will just assume that this is what you meant to say.
If you're going to say...
If you're talking about the verb, or if you talk about the verb...
If it's lirot, then it's einayim. If you're talking to eat, then it's the peh. If you're going to smell the incense, it's the...
Expect this tractate to be called Masechet Re'ia. As a matter of fact, the first word in Masechet Chagiga is Re'ia. That's the first word of the Masechet. So that's really what it should have been named. The Masechet Chagiga is giving us different ways that one was supposed to see God during Shloshet HaRegalim. It starts by talking about bringing sacrifices. So one way that Chazal must have understood the meaning of seeing the face of God was by bringing God something. Right, when you visit a king like Yosef, lo tavo lirot panai ki im bevo achichem itchem. Right, don't see my face if you don't bring something while you come. So one way Chazal was trying to make sense of this expression was talking about sacrifices that one was supposed to bring while visiting Yerushalayim. So when you visit the Beit HaMikdash, you bring something, and that's equivalent to seeing God. The sacrifice that one was bringing during those Aliyah LaRegel is actually called Korban Re'iyah. That's the name of the Korban. Another form or another way of viewing the face of God that appears in Masechet Chagiga was probably connected to learning or thinking, contemplating about God. And that's an expression that appears in the second chapter of Masechet Chagiga. It talks about Listakel B'Ma'ase Merkava. All those texts that talk about mystical observations are also part of Masechet Chagiga, perhaps another idea how one is able to see the face of God. But I want to focus on the very last Mishnah, or maybe the very last two Mishnayot of that entire tractate. The Mishnah ends by the following words. This is the third parak of Masechet Chagiga, which is the last chapter. And it says as follows. Misha'avar ha-regel, hayu ma'avirin, על טהרת עזרה. כיצד מעבירים על טהרת עזרה? מטבילים את הכלים שהיו במקדש. So the Mishnah is talking about what happens once the holiday is over. And it talks about this need to purify the temple court. And the Mishnah asks, how is that being done? How did they undertake the purification of the temple court? And they answer, they immerse the vessels which were in the temple. כיצד מעבירים על טהרת עזרה? מטבילים את הכלים שהיו במשכן. So they used to do תפילה in order to purify each one of the vessels. Why did they need to do that? So one can think, one can suggest, it's like cleaning the temple after the Chag is over. You know, the place must have been crowded with millions of people going in and out, so it's a way of saying they just cleaned the entire district after the Chag. But if you read the Gemara says something very different. And when I read that for the first time, I was just shocked. And you also must be shocked, at least pretend you're shocked just like me, when I read how the Mishnah interprets those verses, or how the Gemara understands this need to purify the temple court, the Azara. So the Mishnah there, the Gemara, reflecting on the Mishnah, says that the reason that needed to be done is because all those vessels were actually presented to people who came to visit Yerushalayim. I want to show you a few examples. Text number one. This is in Masechet Yoma, Talmud Bavli. Amar Rav Ktina. Rav Ktina says, Beshaa shayu Yisrael olim laregel, whenever Israel came up to the festival, megalelim lahem et haparochet, the curtain would be removed, umarim lahem et hakruvim, and the kruvim would be shown to them, shayu meurim ze bazeh, and their bodies would be intertwined with one another, ואומרים להם, ראו חיבתכם לפני המקום כחיבת זכר ונקבה. And they would tell them, look, you are beloved before God as the love between man and woman. Now, this is fascinating. We see that people come during Aliyah LaRegel, during the festival, and what do they see? They remove the parochet, and of all things, they're not even just showing them the ark. What are they showing them? What are they showing them?
The kruvim.
And why are the kruvim significant? Because we just mentioned before, because the kruvim have, they have faces.
Faces, and isn't God supposed to be speaking to us from above the center between them, the space, the
right, that's but face. You still see that you show them on a physical, on a physical level, not just as a, it's not a, you know, an allegory. It's talking about something that actually took place. They removed the curtain. People were seeing the kruvim. I said, wow, is it possible that somebody was thinking about seeing God's face through viewing the kruvim? But if you're still not convinced.
It's getting close. It's getting very close to.
Look at the next one. Look at the next one. Look in Masechet, in Yerushalmi, on Masechet Chagiga. And this is already referring to the Mishnah that we just read before. The purification of the court as soon as the holiday is over. The Yerushalmi says, Amar Rabbi Ami b'shem Rabbi Shimon ben Lakish. Rabbi Ami says in the name of Rabbi Simon ben Lakish, Hashulchan lama tameh? Why is the table becoming considered impure? Lo mipnei shemotzi'in oto umar'in oto le'olei regalim? Isn't that because one was removing it and showing it to the pilgrims? We're talking about the Shulchan. We spoke about the Kruvim. Now we're also speaking about the Shulchan. Now, if I had to guess which part of the Shulchan they were supposed to see. So we want to assume it has to do with the face. With Lechem HaPanim. Well, look in the Bavli. In the Bavli, talks about showing the people of Israel Lechem HaPanim. Melamed, look at number five. Melamed, shemagbihin oto, when people used to visit the court, umar'in bo le'olei regalim lechem hapanim. They used to show through it to the pilgrims that showbread, whatever you call it, lechem hapanim. Ve'omrim lahem re'u chibatchem lifnei hamakom. So we found people observing the kruvim. We find people observing lechem hapanim. Even the menorah was something that was presented to the people when they came. And this appears in the Tosefta. It talks about the dipping or the tefillah of the menorah past the holidays. Ma'aseh v'itbilu et ha-menorah b'yom tov. V'ayu tzedokim omrit bo uru'u proshim shematbilim et me'or ha-levana. So the Sadducees are making fun or mocking the Pharisees. But here too, we see that the menorah was also something that was that needed to be purified, probably because people were observing it. I conclude, my suggestion is that in some crazy level, and I can't explain the history of this practice, but I think it's already rooted in the formulation of the Torah. And on some level, again, it was also understood that way. In some period by Chazal, people actually understood that going and visiting Yerushalayim and viewing the vessels, viewing the face of God represented by the Kruvim, by Lechem HaPanim, by Pnei HaMenorah, was in a way the technique or the mean that one was able to see the face of God. So the Torah might not be just leaving us, you know, this mystery, what does it mean? Maybe the Torah is giving us some clue. Hamikdash, the temple, is supposed to represent something about God. And when you come and visit, and when you see certain elements in the Mishkan, maybe by doing that, you were seeing God. I know I'm not solving the big problem. The big problem is going to remain, right? God doesn't have a face. And God is giving us a very clear message. Lo ta'aseh lecha pesel v'chol tmuna. You're not supposed to make any pesel and you're not supposed to make any tmuna. And 2 seconds later, we have those four parashiyot that talk about so much physical aspects of Mishkan, place where God is supposed to dwell. So that mystery I'm not going to solve here. And I didn't create that problem. That's the Torah's problem. That's not my issue. Also, the root, lefasel, is such a poor choice. We're talking in our parasha that Moshe, vayifsol shnei luchot avanim. What a poor choice of words to say that Moshe is doing mefasel luchot avanim. 2 seconds after lo ta'aseh lecha pesel, to use the same verb for luchot avanim. But those are not my problems. So you can't, you know, blame me for coming up with those problems. That's something that is rooted in the Torah itself. But at least I think what the Torah is giving us is some understanding what the Mishkan meant. The Mishkan is not just an abstract idea, but something about it was beyond the abstract. It was something that one was supposed to experience in a physical way. It was supposed to do something and touch your senses also, because people have that need to think about God in a physical manner and not just in an abstract form. I'm not saying that people thought that the faces of the Kohanim are the face of God, or that the face, Lechem HaPanim, is God. But maybe it was a way of communicating with God through something that was somewhere in between. Yes.
I can't hear you. Yeah, thank you. Does anybody talk about the reason that this appears here, i.e. after Ma'aseh HaEgel, is because it became, you know, painfully evident that they really did need, even though we're not supposed to have, Lo Ta'asu Kol Pesel L'chol Tmuna, that they really did need something, particularly.
It makes a lot of sense. But the commandment of building the Mishkan comes before Chet HaEgel.
Right, but I mean the particularities of turning the re'eh, the commandment to see, and the problem with the active versus passive.
I don't know. I didn't see. Look, the panim that I referred to appear beforehand. And does the Torah change the nature of the Mishkan due to the Chet HaEgel? I don't know. This set of parshiot is just very confusing. Because on the one hand, it's giving us the sense that we're supposed to be abstract. We're supposed to have a very abstract notion of what God is. And at the same time, you have so much zahav, kesef, and nechoshet. On the one hand, we're so upset with the Israelites for using zahav to build the egel. And 10 seconds later, they're supposed to collect zahav for the Mishkan. You know, this is going to remain a problem. We're not going to resolve that.
Okay.
Is one responding to the other or not? It's hard to say. I just want to conclude with one interesting insight, and that's done, and then I'm done. There's something fascinating that you encounter when you check another version of the Torah, and I'm referring to the Samaritan version of the text. In the Samaritan version, we have a crazy change in one of those instances in our parasha. We have benusach haMesorah in the Masoretic text, shalosh pamim b'shana yirae kol zruha. Et pnei ha'adon Hashem Elohei Yisrael. In the Samaritan text, and I don't know what to make of that. I'm just quoting. It says, Shalosh pa'amim b'shana yira'e kol zchucha et pnei. Word Adon does not appear. What appears there? Number two. You see what we have there?
Well, it's very interesting because often when the Torah is actually transcribed, the letters that have a little what we used to call feet or arms, that the resh that can become a dalet or a dalet could become a resh, those letters are often mistranscribed.
Okay, so I have to accept what you're saying and also argue with what you're saying.
Okay.
So we need to take into account that the script changed its form, and what the shapes of the current letters in the Assyrian script is not similar to the original form of the alphabet. So Resh and Dalet actually do not appear similar in the ancient form of the alphabet. However, mm-hmm. what you are right about is that Resh and Dalet do tend to switch in many other verses in the Torah, and scholars actually address that to the way that they were pronounced, and not necessarily to their shapes.
Mm-hmm.
But if that's true, so it's just another, you know, mistake. But what I want to emphasize is that here you have Ha'aron replacing Ha'adon, meaning we have a verse that talks about seeing three times, one is supposed to see three times a year, Pnei Ha'aron. Is that a coincidence? I don't know. And one more last thing, also very interesting, in Sefer Yoshua, look at the following verse. Hine Aron HaBrit, Adon Kol HaAretz Over Lifneichem. Or later on, V'aya Kenoach Kapot Ragle HaKohanim Nosei Aron Hashem, Adon Kol HaAretz. Aron and Adon keep switching here. It's as if Aron HaBrit is Adon Kol HaAretz. Now, if I take that and read it back into the verse we saw at the beginning on the top of the screen, Shalosh Pa'im B'Shana Yira'e Kol Tzrucha Et Pnei HaAdon Hashem, if HaAdon Hashem is Aron HaBrit, so that would mean that seeing Aron HaBrit means seeing Et HaAdon Hashem, right? Aron HaBrit, Adon Kol HaAretz. I can't say anything beyond that, but I think it's a very interesting combination of these two terms, one next to the other, whether it's an alternative version, like in the Samaritan text, or two words that appear in a very close context. But it again gives us the sense that maybe at some point one understood that seeing the face of God, the face of the Lord, God the Lord, was seeing Aron HaBrit.
Also, there is a reference in Yehoshua later in 20-something when God and Reuven do bring not a karban, it's a mizbeach, it's unclear, and they called it hamar'eh. It's to be seen, but they were not bringing it as a karban. It was just
okay,
like...
Okay, so you should send us in the chat, tell us in the chat where that appears.
It's so like chaf dalet or something, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
It's
okay, that would be a very interesting addition to our theory, right? That we're talking about something physical that is being seen.
Right. But they didn't do a karban. It was more like, you know, sort of thankful. And it was at Shiloh.
Yeah. Okay. So I think we're trying to summarize what we saw. We saw a lot of stuff today. A lot of room for a lot of thoughts, I think, seeing these parshiot like this. So we tried to address, we started by coming up with a radical suggesting how the text was supposed to have been pronounced, and we suggested that the original reading was that one is supposed to see the face of God, and I think that is very clear that this is a very reasonable argument, and that it was only revised because the expression sounded too radical. Once we accomplished that the original reading was different, so we spoke about the mystery. So how can one see the face of God? And rather than just dismissing it as in a symbolic way of saying coming close to God or feeling God's nearby, perhaps there was some ancient understanding that it was being carried out in the physical sense by coming, visiting the Mishkan and seeing the places in the Mishkan where the face of God was presented. And what surprises is that it actually has some evidence in Safrut Chazal. Okay, I'm stopping the share. I'm stopping my screen. And I hope everything was clear at least. And I hope to see you again in the future.
Hope so too. Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Gaffney. And thank you for everyone who joined and participated here on Zoom today. And also those who watch us live on Facebook. Next week, we have Sophia Stepansky, who will be teaching on Parashat Vayakhel. And so I'm looking forward to seeing you there as well. And good to see you, Dr. Gaffney, and everyone. Lehitraot.
Okay, bye-bye.